The opening hymn is in the Catholic Book of Worship, number 590, On This Day, the First of Days, 590. Please stand.
In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. The grace and peace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all. My dear brothers and sisters, let us call to mind our sins, and so prepare ourselves to celebrate the sacred mysteries. You are sent to heal the contrite of heart. Lord, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy.
You came to call sinners. Christ, have mercy.
Christ, have mercy.
You are seated at the right hand of the Father to intercede for us. Lord, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy.
May Almighty God have mercy on us, forgive us our sins, and bring us to everlasting life.
Glory to God in the highest, and on earth peace to people of good will. We praise you, we bless you, we adore you, we glorify you, we give you thanks for your great glory. Lord,
Almighty and merciful God, by whose gift your faithful offer you right and praiseworthy service, grant, we pray, that we may hasten without stumbling to receive the things you have promised. Through our Lord Jesus Christ, your Son, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, God, forever and ever.
A reading from the book of Deuteronomy. Moses spoke to the people, "May you, and your children and your children's children fear the Lord your God all the days of your life, and keep all his decrees and his commandments that I am commanding you, so that your days may be long. Hear therefore, O Israel, and observe them diligently, so that it may go well with you, and so that you may multiply greatly in a land flowing with milk and honey, as the Lord God of your fathers has promised you. O hear, O Israel, the Lord is our God, the Lord alone. You shall love the Lord your God with all your heart, and with all your soul, and with all your might. Keep these words that I am commanding you today in your heart. The word of the Lord.
The responsorial psalm is number 203, 203.
A reading from the letter to the Hebrews. The priests of the first covenant were many in number because they were prevented by death from continuing in office. But Jesus holds his priesthood permanently because he continues forever. Consequently, he is able for all time to save those who approach God through him, since he always lives to make intercession for them. For it was fitting that we should have such a high priest, holy, blameless, undefiled, separated from sinners, and exalted above the heavens. Unlike the other high priests, he has no need to offer sacrifices day after day, first for his own sins, and then for those of the people. This he did once for all when he offered himself. For the law appoints as high priests those who are subject to weakness. But the word of the oath, which came later than the law, appoints a son who has been made perfect forever. The word of the Lord.
Hallelujah.
Lord be with you. A reading from the Holy Gospel according to Mark. One of the scribes came near and heard the religious authorities disputing with one another. And seeing that Jesus answered them well, he asked him, "Which commandment is the first of all?" Jesus answered, "The first is, 'Hear, O Israel, the Lord your God, the Lord is one. You shall love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, with all your mind, and with all your strength.' And the second is this, 'You shall love your neighbor as yourself.' There is no other commandment greater than these." Then the scribe said to him, "You are right, teacher. You have truly said that he is one, and besides him there is no other. And to love him with all the heart, with all the understanding, with all the strength, and to love one's neighbor as oneself, this is much more important than all whole burnt offerings and sacrifices." When Jesus saw that the scribe answered wisely, he said to him, "You are not far from the kingdom of God." After that, no one dared to ask Jesus any questions. The Gospel of the Lord. So through the month of October and going into next week, we've been doing the last year's First Communions and Confirmations. And we're almost done this next Saturday. We have one more school to go through for the confirmation, and then we'll be done. But in doing the confirmations, in reading the first reading today, something stuck out to me since I've been confirming a lot of people lately. And that is what Moses says in the first reading, "So that your children and your children's children may fear the Lord your God all the days of your life." May fear the Lord your God. Now we know fear of the Lord is one of the gifts of the Holy Spirit that has received a confirmation. But what is fear of the Lord? I think many times when we think of fear of the Lord and we think of fear, we cower in the corner and go, "Oh no, I don't want this to happen." We become afraid of God. That's not fear of the Lord. Fear of the Lord is not being fearful of God, being afraid of God, all worried and doing whatever. But rather, what that gift of fear of the Lord is, what Moses is saying to the people of Israel, is fear of the Lord is having a wonder and awe of the Lord. It is not cowering in the face of God, but rather seeing how much the love of God is truly present, being with awe and wonder, aware of the glory and majesty of God. That is what fear of the Lord is, being aware of the glory and majesty of God. Being aware that God has perfect knowledge, that God is perfect goodness, that God is perfect power, and that God is perfect love. The perfection of God, and how God comes to us in that perfection. And if we look at our lives, if we take a good look at our lives through our spiritual life, we should be able to see where God has shown us his awe and wonder, where God has shown us his glory and majesty, where God has shown us his perfect knowledge, his perfect goodness, perfect power, and perfect love. But many times, we can't see the forest because of the trees. And the same is true of the majesty and glory of God, that awe and wonder we should have of God. We can't see it at times because of what's happening in our life. Hopefully, and I'm assuming a lot here, hopefully when we see the glory and majesty of God in our daily life, hopefully we see that those who are married to their spouse. How you've come to, God brought you together. How God, through the graces, through your long marriage, if you've had a long marriage, how God has been there to help, to guide, to bring peace, to bring comfort. The glory and majesty of God working. That fear of the Lord, that awe and wonder of what God has done. And the same is true of birth of children, I'm sure, that glory and majesty, the awe and wonder of bringing new life into the world, of God allowing to be a parent to this child. Holy orders for myself. So it's not about being afraid of God. It is about being, having that glory and majesty of God, that wonder and awe in our daily life. What awe does, if we have that awe, that fear of the Lord, we see the desire. We have a desire within our lives. God desires to be with us. That should alone give us awe and wonder, that God wants to be friends with us. And then hopefully we, in turn, when we see the awe, the wonder, the majesty, the love of God, we want to be friends with God. And we see that perfection of God, how God is truly perfect in all ways, that we desire that perfection. We desire that friendship with the Lord. After all, isn't that what St. Augustine said? My heart is restless till it rests in thee, my Lord. We tend to look for these desires and perfections away from God and what the world has to offer. But that is only fleeting. What God has to offer is permanent. That fear of the Lord, that awe and wonder. St. Thomas Aquinas, the great angelic doctor, says, fear of the Lord, that fear is a fear of separating oneself from God. A fear of separating oneself from God. Once again, it is not a fear of punishment. And I think we have that when we think of God. We think of God as a punisher. We think of God as Santa Claus, keeping a list. Seeing when I do good, seeing when I do bad and sin, and then checking a list and going, yeah, well, that Father Bergsma, yeah, that's not looking too good for him. Better wear some sunscreen. But unfortunately, we treat God like that. God's here to punish. God's here to make sure, oh, all the sins I've done, God's here to condemn me to hell. But that's not true. Not true at all. As we know, God came here to save us. So what does Thomas Aquinas mean by fear of separating ourselves from God? He means a fear of offending God. Not a fear of punishment. We don't want to offend God. And I think we all have people in our lives, whether it be our spouses, our children, whoever, someone that's very important to us, someone we love dearly, who we don't want to offend. We don't, can't stand offending. This is the same with God. That fear of the Lord, the fear is of, I don't want to offend God who loves me. I'm not worried about punishment. I just don't want to offend. And when we start to do that, we start to have a better understanding of the gift of fear of the Lord. We start to understand that God is all powerful. Humanity is not. We start to have the second gift of the Holy Spirit for the confirmation of that wisdom. Fear of the Lord is the beginning of wisdom, because we begin to understand who God truly is. A loving, merciful Father who wants to be with us, who wants friendship with us. Not someone, as I said, ready to condemn us. When we start to have that fear of the Lord, that awe and wonder, that seeing the majesty and glory of God, then we start to have a proper understanding of who God is and our relationship with God. That we start to understand that we, as human beings, we're infinite. Or sorry, we're finite. God's infinite, we're finite. That God is infinite, we're finite. That we are dependent on God. And we all know this. We can see in our lives where if it wasn't for God here or God there or God giving me the graces, man, I don't know where I would be. We're dependent on God for for his goodness, his love, and his mercy. We're dependent on God for us to understand that we are loved by God, and that God is the all-powerful creator. When we start to understand that, then our mindset changes once again, right? Because we are no longer God. Because you know the world likes to be God, and we at times like to be God as well. But when we have that fear of the Lord, that awe and wonder and majesty of God, and we have that proper understanding of our relationship with God, then we can truly understand that I need God. Therefore, by the grace of God, I go. We've all heard that saying. When we accept that gift of fear of the Lord, that awe and majesty of God, then we start to have a profound reverence and affection for God. We start to give ourselves over to God. We are able to finally hear, to experience, to sense, to know that the Lord God is one. We have to love the Lord God with all our heart, mind, soul, and all being. That our desire is always to please God. Once again, not out of fear, but out of love. And we know those in our life that we love, our desire is always to please that person, not to do harm to that person. And the same should be true for us with God. When we have that fear of the Lord, we allow it to come into our heart, mind, being, mind, and soul, and give our everything to be with the Lord, then we can truly love our neighbor as ourself, as the last part of the gospel is. Because we know that we have been loved, profoundly loved, more than we could ever understand, by our Savior in heaven, and then we can give that to our neighbor. So as we continue to celebrate this Holy Eucharist, let us, like Moses tells the Israelites, so that your children, your children's children, may fear the Lord, our God, all the days of our life. Together, let us proclaim the faith that makes us one. I believe in God, the Father Almighty,
creator of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, who was conceived by the Holy
for our loving God, to use the gift of prayer for those in need.
The response is, Lord, hear our prayer.
Lord, hear our prayer.
That the Church may encourage all the labor by which the laity shapes society in accordance with the gospel, we pray.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For all parishioners for whom this Mass is offered, we pray.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For all teachers and school administrators, that the wisdom of the Holy Spirit may guide their important work, we pray.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For widows and orphans, for the marginalized and the oppressed, and for the unborn children in danger of being aborted, we pray.
Lord, hear our prayer.
That those burdened with illness may know the love that Jesus has for them, through the love and care extended by their families and friends, we pray.
Lord, hear our prayer.
That those who have died may rest with the Lord for all eternity in the heavenly kingdom, especially Vincent Bolzon, we pray.
Lord, hear our prayer. God, our Father, we have come before you with humble and contrite hearts. We ask you to answer these prayers through your Son.
The offertory hymn is number 531, For the Beauty of the Earth, 531.
Pray, brothers and sisters, that my sacrifice and yours may be acceptable to God, the Almighty Father. May these sacrificial offerings, O Lord, become for you a pure oblation, and for us a holy outpouring of your mercy. Through Christ our Lord. The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them up to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is truly right and just, our duty and our salvation, always and everywhere to give you thanks. Lord, Holy Father, Almighty and Eternal God, for when your children were scattered afar by sin, through the blood of your Son and the power of the Spirit, you gather them again to yourself, that a people formed as one by the unity of the Trinity, made the body of Christ and the temple of the Holy Spirit, might to the praise of your manifold wisdom be manifest as the church. And so, in the company with the choirs of angels, we praise you, and with joy we proclaim.
In the name of the Lord.
You are indeed holy and to be glorified, O God, who loves the human race, and always walk with us in the journey of life. Blessed indeed is your Son, present in our midst when we are gathered by his love. And when, as once for the disciples, so now for us, he opens the scriptures and breaks the bread. Therefore, Father most merciful, we ask you to send forth your Holy Spirit to sanctify these gifts of bread and wine, that they may become for us the body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ. On the day before he was to suffer, on the night of the Last Supper, he took bread and said the blessing, broke the bread, and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and eat of it, for this is my body, which will be given up for you." In a similar way, when supper was ended, he took the chalice, gave you thanks, and gave the chalice to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and drink from it, for this is the chalice of my blood, the blood of the new and eternal covenant, which will be poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in memory of me." The mystery of faith. Therefore, Holy Father, as we celebrate the memorial of Christ, your Son, our Savior, whom you led through his passion and death on the cross to the glory of the resurrection, and whom you have seated at your right hand, we proclaim the work of your love until he comes again, and we offer you the bread of life and the chalice of blessing. Look with favor on the oblation of your church, in which we show forth the paschal sacrifice of Christ that has been handed on to us, and grant that, by the power of the Spirit of your love, we may be counted now and until the day of eternity among the members of your Son, in whose body and blood we have communion. And so, having called us to your table, Lord, confirm us in unity, so that together with Francis our Pope and Douglas our Bishop, Wayne his auxiliary, with all bishops, priests, and deacons, and your entire people, as we walk your ways with faith and hope, we strive to bring joy and trust into the world. Remember our brothers and sisters who have fallen asleep in the peace of your Christ, and all the dead whose faith you alone have known. Admit them to rejoice in the light of your face, and in the resurrection give them the fullness of life. Grant also to us, when our earthly pilgrimage is done, that we may come to an eternal dwelling place and live with you forever, there in communion with the Blessed Virgin Mary, Mother of God, with Blessed Joseph, her spouse, with the apostles and martyrs, and with all the saints. We shall praise and exalt you through Jesus Christ, your Son. Through him and with him and in him, O God, Almighty Father, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all glory and honor is yours forever and ever. Amen. 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 At the Savior's command, informed by divine teaching, we dare to say, Our Father. Amen.
forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil.
Deliver us, Lord, we pray, from every evil. Graciously grant peace in our days, that by the help of your mercy, we may be always free from sin and safe from all distress, as we await the blessed hope and the coming of our Savior, Jesus Christ. Lord Jesus Christ, who said to your apostles, "Peace I leave you, my peace I give you," look not on our sins, but on the faith of your church, and graciously grant your peace and unity in accordance with your will, who live and reign forever and ever.
Amen.
The peace of the Lord be with you always.
Amen.
Let us offer each other a sign of peace. Behold him who takes away the sins of the world. Blessed are those called to the supper of the Lamb. Lord, I am not worthy you should enter under my roof. Only say the word and my soul shall be healed.
The communion hymn is number 601, Gather Us Together, number 601.
Us one bread, one body. In your love.
Let us pray. May the working of your power, O Lord, increase in us, we pray, so that renewed by these heavenly sacraments, we may be prepared by your gift for receiving what they promise. Through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Monday is All Saints' Day, that's tomorrow. We will have Mass at 8 a.m. and 12 noon. So tomorrow for All Saints' Day, Mass at 8 a.m. and 12 noon. Tuesday is All Souls' Day. We will have the regular morning Mass at 8 a.m. and we will also have Mass at noon and 7 p.m. So for All Souls' Day, Tuesday, 8 a.m., noon, and 7 p.m. The Lord be with you. May Almighty God bless you and keep you. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Go forth. The Mass is ended.
Thanks be to God. The closing. Praise to the Lord, the Almighty, 5, 6, 4.
Thank you.